Hello and welcome to this session in which we would look at employee-related liabilities. This is part 3 of 4 discussing current liabilities. In the first session, we looked at what is the big idea of current liabilities. We defined current liabilities, we defined current assets because current assets were needed in order to explain current liabilities, and we looked at the operating cycle. In the first session, we specifically covered accounts payable and notes payable. In the second session, we looked at dividend payable, customer advances and deposit, unearned revenue, sales taxes payable, and income taxes payable. In this session, we would look at the employee-related liabilities. What are the employee-related liabilities and how do they work? The best way to illustrate this concept is to actually look at a sample paycheck. For example, this paycheck in here, the individual worked for 50 hours. They earn $50 an hour, so the total current earnings is $2,500. Now, in financial accounting, what we learned is we debit wages expense, $2,500. We credit cash, $2,500. And this is what we learned in our financial accounting or introductory accounting course. Well, in the real world, this does not happen. In the real world, what happens is the employee will have to pay their taxes. So what's going to happen? The employee will have to pay certain taxes, which we're going to be covering in this session, such as FICA Medicare tax, for example, $36 this period. And so far, this employee paid $1,631.25. FICA Social Security tax, $155. And this employee paid so far $6,975. Federal tax, California state tax, which is state tax, SDI, I believe this is state disability insurance tax, so on and so forth. We could have more deductions. Then the employee will have a net pay. So notice they were paid $2,500. This is the gross amount. Then they deducted $959.19 from their paycheck, and the cash that they receive is $1,514. Therefore, the cash has to be $1,540.81, and those remaining deductions that they were taken away from the employees, those will be various liabilities for the difference. So simply put, amount owed to employees for salary and wages are reported as current liabilities. So those amounts, the deductions that the employer took from you, for the employer, those are liabilities. So current liabilities could include, obviously, payroll deduction, of course, that's the biggest one. That's including taxes. For example, notice here we took taxes, and we could have many type of taxes. We could have federal taxes. As you notice in this paycheck, they took federal taxes. We could have state taxes, which is for the state. And in some states, we could have local taxes. For example, in Pennsylvania, we have a local tax. For example, there is no local tax in New Jersey, but there is a local tax in Pennsylvania. Also, the employee will pay Federal Insurance Contribution Act, FICA, Social Security. We're going to talk about this a little bit more in details. The employee also pay FICA Medicare. Notice here, FICA SS, FICA Medicare. And we could have other taxes. The employee could pay insurance from their paycheck. They can have savings taken out from their paycheck. They can have 401k deductions taken out from their paycheck. Whatever they want to have taken out from their paycheck, the employer would withhold, but it will be considered for the employer a current liability. Let's start to dive into each one of those FICA, starting with FICA, Federal Insurance Contribution Act. The Federal Insurance Contribution Act has two parts, Social Security and Medicare. And notice here on the paycheck, if you notice here, let me highlight this in yellow, maybe it will stand out. Notice we have two FICAs. We have FICA Med and FICA SS. So it has two parts, FICA Medicare and FICA Social Security. Now the Social Security is also known as the old Age Survivor and Disability Insurance, or OASDI, OASDI. Just know that it has another name. Now, when did Social Security started? Social Security started in 1937 after the Great Depression. Now, why is that important? It's important to understand the purpose of Social Security. The purpose of Social Security is once an employee retires, once they reach a certain age, they can have, they can receive a paycheck from the government. It's not really from the government, it's their money. But think of it as a government-sponsored employee retirement plan. Think of it that way. So basically, you pay to the system now, you will get money when you retire. This is the purpose of Social Security. And the reason it came after 1937, after the Great Depression, because in the Great Depression, many people lost all their savings, As a result, the government says, we need a solution for this. And the solution is to have a government-sponsored retirement plan where at least the employee, even if they don't save privately, the government will help them. Will help them when they retire. So who pays Social Security? Obviously, you just saw the employee pays Social Security, but what you did not see yet is also the employer pays Social Security. So two parties pay Social Security, and you're gonna see how in a moment. The employee, as you saw on the paycheck, pay Social Security. Also, the employer will pay the same amount. Simply put, let me just kind of plant the seed here. You notice here that the employee paid $155 this period. The employer, which is you don't see on the paycheck, will have to come up with $150. You don't see it. We're going to talk about it later. So the employer also pay. How much do they pay? How much do you pay in Social Security? Well, there's a rate. The rate is 6.2%. Well, let's see if this rate is correct. So if the employee earned $2,500 this period, and we multiply this by 6.2%, we'll get $155. So how did you come up with this $155? We multiply this amount by 6.2, the gross wages, and we come up with $155. So the rate is 6.2%. This could change, but usually it does not change. Up to a limit. What do we mean by a limit? This is important. In 2021, the tax limit is $142,800. What does that mean? It means if this is zero wages, as long as the employee have not reached, this is the limit, $142,800, and this is the limit specifically in year 2021. The employee and the employer will keep paying Social Security. So simply put, to tell you in another way, so the maximum Social Security an employee pays per year, employee as well as employer, because they have to pay the same thing. If we take 142,800 times 6.2% is $8,853.60. So this is the maximum. Why? Because once the employee earned more than 142,800, they stop paying Social Security. So the Social Security tax stops at some point when that employee reaches a certain amount. Now in 2022, they're raising the limit to 147. So in 2022, they're raising the limit to 147. What does that mean? It means the government wants to collect more money from people. How do they do it? They raise the limit. But at some point, you stop paying Social Security. And the reason is you stop paying Social Security because when you take out your Social Security money, when you're retired, you are limited to a certain income. That's why your deduction is limited and your contribution is limited. Your contribution is limited, how much you contribute is limited, and your income is limited. So that's very important to understand when it comes to Social Security, and very important to understand the idea of a limit. In other words, you don't keep paying Social Security forever. So for example, Bill Gates only pay $8,853.60, although you know, they could be making millions of dollars, let's assume, in wages, and someone else who only made $150,000 per year will pay the same amount because they're above the limit, so they stop paying Social Security. Now, what's the limit in 2023? It's really unknown. Why? Because the limit changes every year, and definitely you would expect that limit to go up with inflation or government need of income or whatever the reason is. So, but the limit changes from year to year. So if you're looking in your textbook now, the limit might be different. So this is about FICA Insurance Contribution Act, part one of two. The second part is Medicare. Before we talk about Medicare, I would like to remind you that whether you are an accounting student or a CPA candidate, to look at my website, farhatlectures.com. I don't replace your CPA review course if you're studying for your CPA or your accounting course. I'm a useful addition. Think of me as a vitamin pill for your education, for your CPA exam preparation. I explain the material differently. I provide you additional resources, CPA exam questions, multiple choice, true, false, to help you understand the topics better. Your risk is 1 month of subscription to give me a try. Try it. If you see it's helping you, you keep it. If not, you cancel. Your potential gain is improving your performance. If not for anything, take a look at my website to find out how well or not well your university doing on the CPA exam. This is a list of all my accounting courses: managerial accounting, advanced accounting, cost accounting, governmental accounting, so on and so forth. My CPA exam modules are aligned with your Becker, Roger, Wiley, Gleam, so it's very easy to go back and forth between my material and your CPA review course. I also give you access to the 1,500 previously released AI CPA questions with detailed solution. If you have not connected with me on LinkedIn, please do so. Take a look at my LinkedIn recommendation, like this recording, share it with others, connect with me on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and Reddit. Now let's go ahead and take a look at the second part of FICA, which is part two of two, which is FICA Medicare. FICA Medicare started in 1965, and the reason is the government had so much money in the Federal Insurance Contribution Act, so they wanted to have another spending spree. It's also known as the hospital insurance, and the purpose of it is very important to understand, is to help retirees with medical expenses. So once you're retired, they will help you with medical expenses. So who pays that Medicare? Who pays FICA Medicare? Well, also the employee and the employer, just like Social Security, both pays Medicare. It's very important to see this. How much do you pay? Well, the rate is 1.45%. And there's no limit. What does that mean? Well, let's go back to that paycheck to show you how FICA Medicare is computed, and I hope they computed it the right way. Remember, when we computed Social Security, we took 2,500 times 6.2. We're going to take 2,500 now and multiply it by 1.45%. And let's do that. Let's do that and see if they computed Medicare correctly. And it's $36.25. And this is how they came up with this figure, $36.25. Now, the difference between Medicare and Medicare and Social Security is Medicare has no limit. What does that mean? It means whether you earned $10,000 or whether you earned $10 million, you keep paying 1.45%. Now, why is Medicare different than Social Security? Well, let me, maybe if I explain it to you, you will remember it rather than memorizing it. Because when you retire, we don't know how much you're going to have in medical expenses. The government don't know whether you're going to incur $0 or $100 million. So what happens is you keep paying. And some people are healthy, they don't need the money. And some people, they are ill and they will need the help. So simply put, that's why there's no limit, in contrast to Social Security. Now, bear in mind, the total FICA is 7.65. Why? 6.2 for Social Security and 1.45 for Medicare. So total is 7.65. So in your textbook, certain textbook, the way they do it, they break down the Social Security and the Medicare. And in some textbook, they combine them. For the purpose of my lecture, I'm going to combine them in one example, then in another example, I'm going to separate them. But you have to understand the difference between the two. So 7.65, remember that 7.65 times 2, because the employer also pays 7.65. Let's talk about other withholding and income tax withholding. Now, employers, your company, is required to withhold federal, state, and in some places, local income taxes from your wages. Who pays this income tax? You pay it. The employee pays their income tax withholding. How much do they pay? Well, it depends. For federal, depending on your W-4 withholding, there's a form you fill out when you are hired. Now, if you want to see this form, how it's worked, go to my income tax course, the Farhat Lectures. And also, you have to pay state and local. For example, in Pennsylvania, we have a local tax. Usually that tax is flat rate. It means 1-3% flat rate. And it's different for each state. And obviously it's different in Pennsylvania for each locality. And just to show you the sample example of the income tax withholding, let's go back to that paycheck that we are looking at. Notice here they have California state tax of $183.76. I'm not really sure how they came up with this. And there's a federal state tax. It doesn't have to be flat. It could be progressive. I'm just saying most states is flat. Where I live in Pennsylvania, it's a flat rate. So maybe in California, it's not. But the point is, they take money away from your paycheck. And notice here we have SDI. I believe this is state disability insurance. You pay it in California. Each state will have different withholding. So simply put, as you can see, your paycheck, you have a lot of money deducted from your paycheck, that you will see that clearly. Now, what you don't see is there are certain taxes that you don't see on your paycheck, but they are paid by your employer. One of those taxes is called State Unemployment or State Unemployment Tax Act, or known as SURA, not FURA, SURA. We're going to look at FURA in a moment. SURA. What is the purpose of SURA, State Unemployment Tax Act? The purpose is to compensate the employee, to pay the employee when they are laid off or let go. So in economic downturn, companies may lay off some employees. As a result, the government says, well, since you lay off the employees, you need to kind of have some sort of an insurance or social insurance protection. And this is the social insurance protection. You might get paid for a year. And when we had the last downturn, the state unemployment tax went for longer than a year. Who pays this tax? Well, the employer. Now, in certain state, and Pennsylvania happens to be one of them, also the employee pay a small part. But for most textbook, and for most states, the majority of the state, only the employer pays this tax. How much do you pay? So how much do the employer pay? Well, since it's a state tax, it will be different. The rate is different in each state. And guess what? The rate is different for each employer in each state. What does that mean? Well, it means one company could be paying 4%, another company could be paying 2%, another company could be paying 5% within the same state. Now, bear in mind, there's a limit. In other words, you don't keep paying that percentage forever. Usually the limit is 7,000 or 8,000, but each state is different. It means once your employer reaches a certain amount of wages, you stop paying state unemployment tax. It's a merit system. Merit system means depending on your company, you could be paying 2, you could be paying 5. What does it depend on? If your company keeps on laying off people, letting people go, then you are using this social insurance program. If you're using the program, you have to contribute more. If your company don't lay off employees and they keep paying into the system, your rate will go down. And this is what we mean by a merit system. For example, in Pennsylvania, if when I was in practice, you would start at 3.7, then it might go up, it might go down. So it doesn't matter what you start with. What matters is what's going to happen next. If you don't lay off employee, the state would say, well, you are not using the system. You should not be paying more taxes, less taxes. Then we have FURA, Federal Unemployment Tax Act. It's also an unemployment federal, it's an unemployment federal insurance program. So you're saying we have a state and a federal. Yes, the federal is to administer help the state when needed. In some years, the state might run out of funds. So as a result, we have a federal insurance program where the federal government will help the state to pay for their employees because they run out of money. Who pays this tax? Who pays FURA? Employer. Employer pays FURA, not employee. How much do they pay? Well, the official rate, I'm going to put the official rate. So if you look at the form, the official rate is 6%. Then, again, this could change from year to year, but right now the rate is 6%. Then the employer gets a credit up to 5.2%. So what does that mean? It means when you start the form, you said, yeah, well, you have to pay 6%. And at some point they'll ask you, are you paying your state unemployment as a company? And you would say, yes, I am in good standing. As a result, they'll say, okay, we're going to deduct 5.2%. And now you are responsible. The net rate for the FURA is 0.8%. What does that mean? It means they will give you a credit. Remember, the federal and the state are, the reason for the state, for the federal program is to assist the state. So if you are paying your state unemployment dues, and most companies do, well, guess what? The government says, well, we're only going to charge you 0.8%. We're going to give you a credit. So let's take a look at a summary. Who pays what? Employee pays their income tax withholding, of course. They pay their FICA Social Security. They pay their FICA Medicare. They pay their medical insurance. They pay their unions. They may participate in charity. They may pay their 401k. This is what are some possible deductions. Okay, could be unlimited. Okay, now what do the employer pay? The employer pay FICA Social Security and FICA Medicare. So simply put those two, whatever the employee pays, the employer will have to come up with the same amount. So if you end up paying $1,000, that's what your paycheck is showing. What's not showing is your employer will have to come up with the same amount of money. Then the employer will pay FURA, Federal Unemployment Tax, and they will pay SUTA, State Unemployment Tax. Now, the best way to illustrate these is to look at a simple example. And the reason I say simple example, because I am not going to be using the limit. So I'm going to stay away from the limit for this example. Don't worry. I have another example where you are required to know how the limit works. But for now, I'm going to keep it simple because, you know, when I introduce the topic, got to keep it simple so students can follow. Adam Company had a weekly payroll of $20,000, entirely subject to FICA and Medicare. So what I did is I said, you know, so those employees that earn $20,000, remember there's a limit. They are all below the limit. None of them reach the limit. So that's why the full amount is subject to FICA, Social Security, and obviously there is no limit for Medicare. So they have to pay 7.65. The federal unemployment rate is 0.8, and the state happens to be 5. Income tax withholding from all employees is $3,500, and the employees deducted health insurance of $1,600. That's all what we have. We don't have a 401k. We don't have any savings account. Those are the savings. So keeping it simple, those are the deduction. Keeping it simple. So what entry would the employee make? Well, they paid the employee $20,000. They will debit salaries, expense, and wages $20,000. Then they're going to start to take out the taxes. Withholding taxes payable, $3,200. So the employee contributed $3,200. Therefore, we're going to credit $3,200 for withholding taxes payable. Could be federal, state, whatever. Then we're going to withhold FICA taxes, FICA Social Security taxes, FICA taxes. We're going to combine both. So notice what I did. I combined both. So this is 6.2 for Social Security, 1.45 for Medicare. Together, 7.65. And we're going to take out 1530. But remember, in the real world, they break them down. Okay, they break them down. Medical insurance, the employee contributed $1,600. So those are the withholding. So what's going to happen, the employee will get a check. The employees, this is for many employees, will get a check of $13,670. And this could be one employee for that matter. This could be one employee, or it could be the whole payroll. It doesn't matter. The entry is the same. But the point is, the net amount, the take-home amount, is $13,670. Are we done yet? No, we're not. Every time we pay the employees, the employer will have a liability. What does that mean? A liability of what? A liability of paying taxes. What is the employer liability? Well, the employer liability is $2,690. How did we come up with this number? Well, let's see. First, the employer will have to match Social Security. We'll have to match Social Security. So notice here. The employee paid $1,530 in Social Security, right here. The employer will have to come up with the same amount, responsible for the same amount. And that's why self-employed people, if you are self-employed, you pay both. If you're self-employed, you pay both. So if you're self-employed, technically, your FICA rate is 7.65 times 2. Why? Because you are the employee and the employer. Now, you will get a deduction, but again, that's a different topic. Yeah, that's covered in my tax course. But as a self-employed, you pay both. Now we have FURA. FURA is 0.8%, so 20,000 times 0.8%. The employer is responsible for 160. And we have, that's FURA, and we have SUTA 5%, which is $1,000. So if my math is right and we add up those three figures, the employer is responsible. There's a payroll tax expense of $2,690. So they paid you $20,000. They paid the employees $20,000, then they are responsible for $2,690 for the government on your behalf because they are the employer. They are required to do so. Now, what's the best way to learn this? Once again, I'm going to work an exercise with limits. So very important to understand how the limits work. I ignore the limit here. Also, it's very important to go to my website and start to work multiple choice questions to consolidate this knowledge. At the end of this recording, I'm going to remind you, whether you are an accounting student or a CPA candidate, you're going to invest in your CPA and your accounting career once for a lifetime. Invest wisely. Don't shortchange yourself. The CPA exam is worth it. Invest in yourself. Invest in your career. Invest in your certifications. You have to pass them once. You put them behind you. You focus on your career and they will pay dividend forever. Good luck. Study hard. And of course, stay safe.